Moving on to item 23. This is to consider a proposed conservation easement to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for a portion of the Spurwink Marsh and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager. Mr. Town Manager.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
That is not his name. It is Mr. McGovern, and I've said that twice. Not to confuse the audience.
For about the fifth or sixth time on the Town Council's agenda is a proposal from the United States Department of the Interior, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, to obtain what is now a conservation easement on town-owned land that is part of the Spurwink Marsh for the Rachel Carson Wildlife Refuge. It's proposed that the conservation easement, in exchange for granting it, that the United States government would pay the town of Cape Elizabeth $37,600. I think from the initial draft that first came to the council, there have been a substantial number of changes, and I'd like to briefly highlight those changes. First of all, instead of it being transferred in fee simple, it's merely a conservation easement. The town will continue to own the land. Secondly, it provides that no building structures or improvements of any kind should be erected on, over, or under the said land, except as needed to provide access for the public for fish and wildlife management for the construction of temporary duck blinds, which are removed at the end of the hunting season. However, all duck blinds existing on the property at the time of conveyance shall be allowed to remain on the land. There was quite a bit of concern that the duck blinds be specifically allowed, they'd be allowed to stay on the land. That provision is now here. The next paragraph, there was concern that the initial draft did not allow our harvesting of various wild berries. This specifically allows the harvesting of wild berries, heather, wildflowers. At one point it said for commercial purposes was prohibited. This allows it for either commercial purposes or for one's own needs. Vegetation may be disturbed for reasons of public safety. Excavating and dumping on the land is not allowed, subject we've had much discussion on tonight. We can do related road work within 75 feet on either side of any current roadway in accordance with regulations. Either we or Rachel Carson could remove debris or refuse at any time. We also have the right to continue to maintain drainage swales, drainage conduits, etc. Motor vehicles aren't allowed except in emergency. If someone, it wasn't in there about motorboats wanting to go in there. Well, it's now permitted that a motorboat could go onto the property. The paragraph 10, a very important one, the grantee agrees the hunting and fishing will continue to be permitted. That was a concern, and that paragraph was added. There was quite a few questions on who could close the property, in case some disease came up, or, medical waste, you name it, with some of the concerns today. That right is left to the town to close the land. There was debate on whether or not they could close it to hunting and fishing. They left that right with the community. There was concern at your last meeting on whether or not we would be notified of fish and wildlife management activities. There is a new paragraph in here that says that Rachel Carson would notify us and keep us informed of various fish and wildlife management activities. There was question about a reversionary clause. There is now a reversionary paragraph in here that the conveyance is made subject to the right of reversion by the grantor herein in the event the United States should cease to use the land for perpetuation of conservation, education, fish and wildlife management purposes. So I think, in summary, there have been a substantial number of changes made. If the town council is interested in a management plan for this particular area, I think the compromises that have been reached make this an excellent management plan, and I would encourage you to approve it this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Michael?
I think it's a real sweetheart. I really do. I think all our concerns have been answered. I really congratulate you, Mike, and Mr. French, or whoever.
Mr. Dyer.
Mr. Dyer, who put it together. Just wonderful. My only question was, I was a little confused about the map and what we were talking about. Are we talking about the hatch area, or are we talking about the whole deal?
Okay, now this is the hatched area. Remember, this is already owned. So we're talking about the land that falls below the river. And it comes up along, down along. These lots are out. And then you come
so
back.
So this is the line.
Yes, everything's
along
south of this tax map line.
Does everyone get that?
Map.
No.
Does everybody?
No.
Billy, you might give a question.
The hatched area is already.
They already own the hatch.
Yes, that's
they
correct. We own the hatched area. And everything below this line here, where it says number 15 in circle, running along the river, down and up and around through here. Wish I had that figure map here. But the hatched area is out. This is, of course, out, and there is a strip, a small portion of critical edge running along here.
Mm-hmm.
But this
that's
is,
not
no, that's not.
Is this 75 feet?
No, it's
one of the questions Mrs. Masterton's asking is that up where the old treatment plant was, where the culvert goes through, the border would actually be moved 75 feet in. That was something we discussed the other day, and they were agreeable to.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah.
Just for the record, my name is Steve Dyer, and I am a realty specialist with the Realty Management Office for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service out of the regional office in Newton Corner, Mass. And I and Mike drew up the document that's in front of you after a number of hours of work and negotiations, and trying to meet the council's concerns as well as meet the concerns of the resource that we share. And I can speak, I think, for Andy French, who's the refuge manager, and Andy's supervisors and my supervisor in the regional office, that the document that I think we've come up with does meet the concerns, I think, of all the parties involved.
I would also like to say for the record that every one of our concerns that Michael just enunciated was met. In other words, it wasn't one where we had a disagreement and the line was drawn in just absolutely no way. So we actually, 100% of what we asked for, we got, just for the home audience, people here, to understand that. But there is one area that I'd like to talk about, which was the appraisal, which we would be paid $37,600. And I was wondering if someone here could verbally give a little synopsis for
yes,
the council, people at home, and the people here, as to how that number was arrived at.
For that, Mike and I talked about it, and earlier we agreed that at the next council meeting, when we brought this before you, that I would ask the appraiser to come up and speak to you about that. And I have Bart Hayes.
Very good.
My name is Barclay Hayes. I work for the federal government. I'm chief appraiser for Region 5, which covers from North Carolina to Canada. I'm a busy person. You wonder how we came up with $37,600. Sometimes I wonder that myself, sir, for giving an easement so liberal as the one we have come up with here. It's mainly because of the bundle of rights in ownership of property. We both share, will share in the bundle of rights in this property. Some of the rights that are taken away or shared are the right to sell the property. The right to enjoy the property fully, as most of the audience does. In this case, we probably won't, because neither one of us can sell it. Neither one of us really enjoy it fully. The right to mortgage the property is another bundle of rights. The right to enter onto the property, egress and ingress, any time you wish to. Transfer of ownership, obtain income from the property, selling berries or whatever we have on this property. And the normal restraint of escheat powers, which is the powers that the town has. Now the town will share some of the powers of the federal government, the federal government will share some of the powers of the town. Originally, the value of the property, as appraised in September 1986, was $76,600. The ownership has been diluted, the bundle of rights have been diluted, and now the value is $37,600. And we came up with that just by sharing these bundle of rights. There's no secret to it at all, it's just the way you do it. In other words, what's left?
Mm-hmm.
Not much.
Mm-hmm. So to clarify it again for everyone, the updated fee value of the tract was $76,600.
No, sir, that's the September 1986.
That's right. And that included $30,000, which was estimated fee value, and $36,600, which is what you call upland severance value.
Right.
So your definition again of why the fee, of why the fee estimated value was reduced, I think that was reduced basically to $1,000 then to come up with
$30,000. Yes.
Because it said it was considerably reduced as it was from $30,000 to $1,000.
Right. Same as the gentleman that got his lots banged here a little while ago. What happens there is that the United States government generally pays about $1,000 for an easement. This is not owning anything in fee. This is just a management easement. And it's usually perpetuity or 50 years. We do usually do things on 50-year cycles. The fee value did get reduced considerably because the fee is not there anymore. It's just an easement. And I read the easement, the 14 articles in the easement, and it's a very nice easement from a management standpoint of view and from Steve's standpoint of view, but as a real estate appraiser's standpoint of view, it's a horror show. There isn't much left on either side. So that's the reason why we reduced it to a minimum transaction value, which was $1,000. It's a good cooperative easement, but there's not much value there.
Thank you for your frank assessment of the situation. It's a pleasure to hear someone not speak bureaucratese, but rather English for a change. I asked. Yes, Councilor Amaral.
Well, we have been discussing this for many, many meetings, many hours, and I would like to, at this point, with great pleasure, move that we enter into a contract with the Rachel Carson Group in the United States Department of the Interior. And that we sell an easement to a portion of the borough marsh for a price of $37,600, and that all of the items of the contract as written here be part of that agreement. If I get that, the motion.
Second.
So moved and seconded then to accept the move ahead with the proposed conservation easement to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service for a portion of Spurwink Marsh. Councilor Cogshell.
I have a question of Mr. McGovern. The proposed change in the Cape Elizabeth Scarborough line, is that going to affect this at all?
I wondered the same question. We're conveying to them the interest that we believe we have in it. Nothing more, nothing less.
And is there a specific fund that this money will be going into?
Yeah, it would be going into the Thomas Jordan Trust Fund.
Okay. Councilor Creelman?
I don't see in the document the actual acreage that we're dealing with. Should it be in the document? Or
I believe it is.
Let me address that. When we draft up a document like this, because as Bart said, we have a limited staff, and we do cover a significant amount of areas and states and that. Initially, you come up with a basic description and an approximate acreage that myself and Mike and Andy and a number of other people have agreed to. Now, once the agreement is entered into, at that point, at the cost of the federal government, a survey is then drawn up, and there is some staking that will probably have to be redone since it's been a while since we started this process. Survey is done. That description is made a part of this document here, which says the deed of easement. This is just something that is attached to the actual agreement as an exhibit, saying that these items now become a legal binding contract in here. When this document, the deed is finalized, in here you know it says insert track description. That's where the survey will come, will be inserted, the description itself. The town will have ample time to review the map. It'll be worked out with Mike and I and and it is plus or minus. Okay.
Okay, I recently saw that Wells involved 58 acres to Rachel Carson or something of that nature, and the people of Cape Elizabeth just ought to know exactly how much land we are granting an easement to. That's all.
It'd be around that approximate acreage figure. It's like I say, it's plus or minus. It's subject to a survey which has not been done yet, and they are normally not done until we know we're going to enter into an agreement. Simply, it's just a matter of expense and time.
Mm-hmm. Councilor Jordan?
I'd just like to say that I think in the motion you ought to authorize the manager to sign the agreement. Would that be fair to have in the motion? I believe he's the one that we're going to have sign the agreement. And also that you say this fund, this will go into the Thomas Jordan Fund?
Yes, sir.
Be there if any, because what if any resident feels they own a portion of that and they don't want it to go as a conservation easement? What do you do then?
Are you asking me or the town manager?
Town manager. What's he going to do with his money?
I will defer. We had discussion on this, I think, 6-9 months ago. I will first defer to the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service, and then he'll probably leave a few holes that I'll have to fill in.
Well, I feel you, once we sign this agreement and you get your money, you're the one that's going to control the purse strings. Don't seem so that they would have much to say about it.
Well, that's not necessarily true. Okay. To the best of our knowledge, we have entered into considerable expense to establish title. Now, I think, I can't speak for some of the new council members, but I know that some of the older council members are well aware that a lot of this land, the title is dubious at best in some occasions because there was an older fire. I guess it destroyed a number of records, and it all dates back from the best our title company and a number of other title companies that we've had looked at it to the will of Thomas Jordan. And that the land, if it is sold, and it does mention the Spurwink Marshes to the town of Cape Elizabeth, that if anything is done to the land, it has to be used for the benefit of the poor. Okay, now, if the language on whether or not it can be sold, that, like I say, that's, okay, one attorney will interpret it, yes, it can, and another one, and if you trace some of the documentation throughout the course of these negotiations for myself, another one will say you can't. So what we did, and myself, which is part of one of the other items that we discussed, is that I would, before we even got to this stage, I would go to the title company and say, can they convey what we have here? The answer to that question was yes. So we are basing the language in here, the language in the document and the agreement, upon what our title company is saying you can do as an owner and we can do as a purchaser. And
yeah, but the town doesn't own it.
Well, we have a title company that says they do.
I thought you just said the Thomas Jordan people own.
No, I said it came to the town through the will of Thomas Jordan.
Not the whole marsh.
Well, to the best of our records and what the title company is telling us, what we have presented to them, which is what you have before you, they're saying that we could go forward with this conveyance, this purchase.
No, maybe I'll pick up where he left the holes.
Thank you.
Okay, I ain't gonna argue with you, but I'm gonna get somebody to produce you a deed that you don't own the whole marsh. If I can get them to do
that's
it.
Fine. That's fine.
And I don't see why you people can't pick it up. Maybe they got burnt in the records way back in the fire and fallout. I don't know. But I know there is some deeds for that Spurwink Marsh.
Portions of it, yes.
Yes, portions of it.
Yes.
And the Thomas Jordan deal only includes the poor farm area, and that doesn't include the whole marsh. No. I think you'll find that out when you get your committee working.
Very good. Councilor Greenlaw?
I don't have any questions for you, Steve. I just want to be a little repetitious, as I said with the past issue on the agenda. I appreciate the perseverance and the hard work on both sides of this. I have, being a new councilor, I haven't been able to sit up here to hear your comments previously, but I have been in the audience and heard presentations on this issue. And I'm delighted with what has been worked out. My feeling is the town is not in a position to be professionally manage a wildlife area. Your organization is, and I think it's an area that really deserves and warrants that kind of management, and I, for one, look forward to working with you in talking about further areas of the marsh.
I'm assuming at some point, should this go through, there'd be appropriate signs and things of that nature, letting people know what's what with regard to
that,
the original person.
Once, yes, that's part of the agreement, that the boundary will be posted, because if it is not posted, you cannot enforce federal law or anything written in this document.
Does anyone from the public, by the way, wish to speak on this issue? Because I'd like to have comments also. Yes.
I'm Fran Ricardo from Cape Elizabeth. I wondered whether or not we have a lawyer represented with Michael, and if we could have Peter Rand of our Conservation Committee at whatever, you know, whatever proceedings are going to be forthcoming. For our own protection.
Have we
gone through that process?
The attorney has looked at this on and off, you know, month after month. Prior to my signing an agreement, he always does review agreements. He will review this one. Dr. Rand, you know, I'd be happy, more than happy to share this with the Conservation Commission. However, and they have been involved in a lot of the earlier discussion of this. I can't say they have been of late, while it's been within the council's purview. The Conservation Commission can't substitute its judgment for an action of the council at this point. Once the council adopts this, it's what the council has adopted that will go forward. This is the final action tonight. But, you know, I'd be more than happy to discuss it with Dr. Rand, but it's the council that does have the final say.
We have really, this is a great plan. I don't think we have anything to lose on this. I think we have all to gain, and we need that protection. We need that protection very badly.
Excuse me, Mrs. McArdle, was there any concern at this point that, on your part, that Dr. Rand ought to be consulted prior to?
No, Dr. Creel, and my only concern was that I had missed out on one meeting and I had not heard at what point Michael was at, or at what point everyone, the committee, you know, where they had arrived. So I'm not so sure that it sounds like everything's said except what William Jordan said, you know, concerning the title. That I do not understand. That I need clarification. I don't understand.
Is there other? Yes.
My name is George Watson. I live on Running Tide Road. It sounds to me as though your proceedings are going to go along and probably go through, but I just wanted to voice my support for the management of this marsh by the U.S. Fish and Wildlife. I've been interested in wildlife and particularly in waterfowl game management for a number of years as an avocation of mine. I've been associated as a member and committee member, et cetera, with Ducks Unlimited really for most of my life. I've been a member since I was 8 years old, and for the last 20 years I've worked in the state as a volunteer in various committees. And currently I serve as kind of a liaison between the Ducks Unlimited of Maine with the Maine Fish and Wildlife in establishing some new waterfowl habitat here in the state of Maine. I don't speak for Ducks Unlimited. It's not a political organization. It doesn't take sides on local issues, but just with my background, knowing the goals of an organization that's very dear to me, I believe that the goals of Rachel Carson really overlay very neatly on top of the goals of Ducks Unlimited. I think this marsh is truly one of the great assets that we have. We're fortunate to have as many as we do in the town, and it must be preserved, and I think probably would be anyway, but the management potential of this marsh, in my view, is really quite enormous. I did not make all the meetings. I was able to view some of the tapes of the previous discussions, and I really congratulate the council for the issues that they raised, and I congratulate the people from U.S. Fish and Wildlife for the accommodations that were able to be made back and forth. I think that with the expertise of the people from Rachel Carson, that you'll find that there will be more wildlife, that you'll see more broods of nesting birds, that you'll see geese coming in the spring more than you do now. There's a lot that can be done with providing habitat and food for waterfowl, and where you find waterfowl, you find a lot of other critters as well that live in that same kind of habitat. So I support it, and I'm glad it appears that you supported it as well.
Thank you very much. Is there any other public comment on this?
Yes.
I just wanted...
Go ahead. Phil, Counselor, would you...
My name is Benson Danny. I live in Cape Elizabeth, and just quickly want to voice my support also for the Rachel Carson people. And I think, as Councilmember Greenlaw said, the more land that you put under their protection of this type, the better off everybody is. And I once again just support it, to voice that.
Thank you. Continuing along this vein, is there any other people in the public that would like to comment? Seeing none, Councilor Gottschall.
I just have a question about the 75 feet on either side of any current roadway, where a roadway can be expanded or work. Is that roughly 150 feet on each side? All of
no, it's a,
the
a
road plus 150. Isn't that a lot?
It is. We wanted to be, it was a significant issue when we were trying to build the Spurwind Bridge. And we were just trying to make sure that any eventuality that ever occurred, that we could widen the roadway, relocate one in conformance with federal and state regulations.
I see public comment. Actually, I see a citizen walking who probably will give public comment. Sorry.
Christ, you're awfully quick.
I must clarify at this hour.
Mr. Chairman, members of the council, my name is John Roberts. I live on Fowler Road, and I also would like to request your support on this. We must begin to act to protect our resources and not just give it lip service. Already, we have a testimony to conspicuous consumption on Spurwink Avenue overlooking the marsh, which I think is a, kind of a travesty. And we need to protect this from happening in the future. This doesn't go as far as I'd like to see it to go, but it certainly is a step in the right direction. Thank you.
Thank you. I would now entertain other comments from the council. The only comment that I'd like to make is paraphrasing something that was said earlier tonight. I guess one person's horror show is another person's good deal. And in light of that, I think we as the citizens of Cape Elizabeth are in fact getting the best of both worlds and being able to continue to retain ownership of this property and yet turn it over to professional managers, which is a very important resource which is now going to be professionally managed at a time when all such resources are coming under tremendous pressure through pollution, through development, and you name it. And I've always strongly supported this, and I'll be most pleased to vote in favor of this evening. So, Councilor Rambo.
Yeah, just one comment. I think we must have a good contract, because of all the positive comments tonight, this has been a very controversial item over the past year. And I think people have come together. I think we have a good contract. I'd like to move the question.
Very good. I'd now like to call for a vote on the motion that is before us. All those in favor of adopting the conservation easement, signify by raising your hand. Any opposed? None. So it passes unanimously 7-0. Thank you very much, everyone involved, once again. If I could beg the council's indulgence for a minute, I would like to move one item out of order, if I could, and take up item number 25. Because we have a person visiting from a neighboring community, and item number 24 could be another in-depth discussion, and I would like to honor a fellow counselor by moving it out. So do I have permission to move this out of order and take item 25 up? Very good. Thank you all very much.
Okay.
Item number 25.
I think he's loose. Used from late meetings in the room.
Steve. Item number 25 revolves around a request from the Vision 2000 for a municipal contribution and take any necessary action. I would like to have an introduction by saying that Vision 2000, for those of you who may not be aware of it, although it has gotten a tremendous amount of publicity, I will use their own words to describe a little bit about what they feel Vision 2000 is all about. It is an effort to involve the people of our region in a constructive process of articulating our concerns, our strengths, our problems, and opportunities that we see. The goal is to define broadly held visions of our community as we want it to be in the year 2000 and to recommend solutions and strategies which will help us achieve this vision. We have, actually we are honored to have with us tonight the Nicholas Kirby, who is a vice chair of Vision 2000. He is also a present member of the Gorham Town Council and the immediate past president of the Council of Governments. So Nicholas, I'd like to give you a very hearty welcome this evening, and I know you'd like to make a little presentation to us.
Thank you, Chairman Latore and members of the council.
I'm here with Nancy Trinward, who is a Cape Elizabeth citizen and very active participant in Vision 2000. I'm here asking for two things. I'm asking for your support. Your support, most importantly, by getting involved in Vision 2000. And if you decide not to get involved in a task force, which I'm going to very definitely ask you to do, to get involved in a task force, but even if you don't do that, to stay very actively informed about what Vision 2000 is doing. The second thing I'm asking you for is a small contribution at the rate of 12.5 cents per person in the community for this year to help support the work of Vision 2000. The reason that I personally am supporting Vision 2000 is that we are all experiencing a lot of change, a lot of growth, and the consensus that I think we all had 10, 15 years ago, that we were working together to encourage economic development, to improve our quality of life, and that we sort of had a general idea as to where we were going, that consensus is now on shakier ground because of all the stress that we are all feeling. You feel it in your councils. I know for a fact. I've sat here for an hour or so and listened. We feel it in our council, I can assure you. And there are just, it is a good time for us to sit back and look at who we are now, where we came from, and where we want to be in the year 2000, and see if we can come up with some consensus, something that we agree on, some general principles that we agree on, and some actions that we can take that will get us there. When you get right down to it, we're all in this together. Cape Elizabeth, Gorham, Portland, Bridgeton, we're all in this together. We're all experiencing this, and therefore it's a time for all of us, government leaders, community leaders, business leaders, to sit down and talk and deal with the complexities. Originally, when this idea came up with over a year ago, it was presented in terms of issues. Well, we'll deal with transportation, or we'll deal with human services, or we'll deal with tax policy. And we all know, because we sit behind a desk, that's not the way it is. All of those issues interact. The complexity of managing ourselves here and now with what we know about transportation and housing and taxes, it's just terribly, terribly complex. And we need to make sure that the various people in our community and business and in community groups and government, that we all understand that complexity in somewhat of the same way, so that we all have a chance to contribute to our understanding of the complexity so that we can deal with it and come up with a new vision and some ways to get to that vision. Vision 2000 is having a large forum, a large community meeting this Wednesday from 4:30 to 6:30 at Michael's Restaurant. You've all been invited. I hope you will decide to come. We have selected, through a relatively long process, 7 challenge areas that we will be looking at. I know you've all had a chance to review the document. So I hope you'll support tonight. I hope that you will get involved in one of the task forces. I hope that you will stay informed, and I hope that you will come to Wednesday's meeting and help us figure out where we want to go.
Thank you very much. If you'd stay up for a minute, is there anyone that would like to ask Nick a question while we have him regarding the Vision 2000? Yes, Councilor.
Nick, just how many communities have you already talked to, and what kind of support have you
had? I personally, this is the third community I've spoken to. Gorham has agreed to participate, and so has Westbrook. Westbrook's a hard sell. So has Westbrook. So this is the third, and as far as I'm not sure about the other communities. No community has said no.
Yes, Councilor. Creelman.
Mr. Kirby, you slipped out there that Westbrook was a hard sell. I had some difficulties reading over the documents, the ones we were mailed, ones we received in the mail, the Robert Kuzner study, Director of Marketing Research for your Greater Portland Area Citizen Survey. The potential bias in this particular survey made me think about really how worthwhile the 1,261 responses were, and that caused me to somewhat question the entire process with regard to, basically, is this a process of sort of reinventing the wheel? I know you're intimately involved with COG. I'm a relatively new member to municipal government. It does seem to me that there are pockets of individuals throughout the greater Portland area perhaps doing the same thing, but doing it to some extent in isolation. And I just wonder, when we start asking the citizens for money, be it only your whatever that amounts to $1,025 for Cape Elizabeth, it does concern me that some of the task forces that you talk about in your proposed document could possibly dovetail the work of the Council of Governments in the greater Portland area. And that's, I only introduce this skepticism having read over these documents twice because I want the money of Cape Elizabeth to be well spent. And unless you convince me otherwise, I think it could be better spent to a variety of projects that I am prepared to mention if asked, but I'll leave it at that for the moment.
Okay. Well, the survey, if that were the only source of information that we had about the needs of the community, I would be darn concerned also. It's not, it's one of several. There have been several large group forums that have brought together hundreds of people from the region to sit down and talk about what they think our problems are, where they want to be, and how we're going to get there. So we have a document 20, 30 pages long of input that we have gotten from citizens in that. And then also we correlated this study with a random selection scientific study that was done by the University of Southern Maine's Growth Management Program before we sent it out. So we did not look at this as being a definitive scientific study because that's not what we're looking for here. What we're looking for is input, lots and lots of input from the people as to what their feelings are about the region. So in terms of the survey, that's sort of how we dealt with that. It's one piece of information in a large pool of different types of information. In terms of reinventing the wheel, I am very familiar with the work that local governments do. I am somewhat familiar with the task force work that businesses do because I'm a business person. And I am somewhat familiar with what community groups do. And if you'll look, what you'll see, the normal way of doing that is to pick an issue, transportation. We have a commuter study that was completed about a year ago. Housing, we have the affordable housing study. It takes one issue, and usually there is one group of people who are focused either in business or in government, sometimes with a couple of token people from somewhere else, and they do a task force format of, well, here's this issue, let's collect data on this issue, and let's come up with recommendations on this issue. It's my contention, my personal belief, that that is too narrow of a way to deal with the complexity that we currently face. That what we have to do is look at these issues in a broader context, such as the challenges, such as the way that we have those challenges framed, and look at how housing is affected by transportation, is affected by tax policy, is affected by land use, and get people who are actively involved in business, in government, in community, to sit down and talk about this together. This is a high-risk venture. It is a very high-risk venture in that it could turn out to be another study that sits on a shelf. I think every town councilor has a responsibility to have that skepticism because we've all seen it happen. But this venture has the potential for very high gain. If we come out of this with a process, the process being just as important as the results, and some action plans that bring us closer together and that help us figure out how we are going to manage our limited resources, our community, better to maintain what we think is important, and I think the survey is pretty good about pinpointing what we think is important, then I think it's been a really good effort. So it's high risk, low cost in terms of money, high cost, I'm asking of you folks, in terms of your time commitment, but if it works, very high gain.
Are there other questions, concerns? Yes, Councilor Masterton.
Nick, you mentioned Bridgeton. Are you getting input from Bridgeton and Sebago and
this the direction will be the catchment area is the county. I do not know how actively involved the Lakes region will become. I can
because
bring it to
sometimes,
that.
You know, we do have great difficulty in drawing in those
we certainly
what
do.
I call out-county region. And I think that their input is every bit as important as ours.
That's why we chose the county. I mean, it was a discussion.
Because it's happening out there, too.
It is happening out there.
It's really happening.
Yeah. Long Lake water study, et cetera.
Councilor Jordan?
Anything that you spoke about this evening, and as I read this document, I can't understand why the Council of Governments can't do the same thing, even though they do take and call it a task force for transportation or passports or one thing or another. So I just get the feeling it's another layer of, while we're working the government, that we're going to start funding, and if it doesn't go up each year, it'll be the first one that ever got started that didn't go up each year.
This last...
Just to keep people out there figuring out what's going to happen in the future, and we already have one set up. Why can't they expand theirs and do the same thing?
This is time limited, just to make that clear. This will last about 12 to 18 months, according to how well the task forces go, then it will end. And this is not the mission of COG. COG is created, is an entity that we created to respond to our needs only. And COG does very little with business and very little with community groups to get them actively involved in our programs. Jane is the first vice chairman of COG, and you know, I think the officers and executive committee of COG would not like to see COG lose its focus on joint services planning and helping us develop the new priorities that we've established over the last year.
I do think, though, that this process that Vision 2000 is doing will help COG in trying to deal, have a better handle on regional planning. It is regional planning as a whole is not something that COG has really been able to do. We haven't pulled together, as Nick has said, the affordable housing issues, the transportation issues, the land use issues, and put them all under one umbrella and say, how is this affecting the whole region? And I do, so I see this process as complementing what COG is doing and adding to, and probably, I would suspect that COG may be, the expectation for COG may be greater at the end of this process.
Thank you. I would also like to add that I've thought long and hard about it as well, in terms of I've been on so many committees that have been what I might call pie in the sky, that we really need to bring some of them down to just tangible results. But what's unique about this is pulling together business people and government leaders, people from a broad spectrum, and that's important. And having served in COG many years as I did, it's good to get governmental leaders and public works directors, et cetera, together. But much more important is going to be the private-public mix. That's going to be the only way that we're going to solve the problems here, not all government or all private. So I'm kind of excited behind that aspect of the Vision 2000, though I do ask that you take back to whoever, please let's have some tangible results, because we don't need more studies saying we want to maintain the quality of life. We know that. Yeah. We need the real hard, nitty-gritty tools. How do we do that? So that's my comment on it. Did I say, yes, Councilor Greenwald.
I'd like to echo what Francis just said about tangible results. That was on my list, too, but I won't get into that. I'm curious how you plan to perhaps implement those results or interface with existing planning efforts, both regional, both with COG and with local planning efforts. I've heard, when I posed this question to some acquaintances, they said, well, what they're trying to do is get people on planning boards to be part of Vision 2000. Are there any other ways you're planning to interface?
Vision 2000 cannot make you pass an ordinance, or me, or anybody. Vision 2000 cannot make a business person decide to invest in a certain way or decide to deal with their employees in a certain way. But Vision 2000 understands that if actions are to be taken, you will take them, and leaders in business will take them, and community groups and people who feel strongly about issues will take those actions. And so by getting all those people together now and having those people actively involved and informed and keeping them very actively involved along the way, then by the time a year, year and a half from now, when we get done with this, you will have had something to do with creating the recommendations that come before this council and every other council in the region for action. So this is not a naive endeavor. We understand that there are authority structures, there are power structures, and people make decisions that affect not only their community, but their neighbors and the region as a whole, and those people have to be involved, and that's why I'm here. You have to be involved if this is going to work, and I think it's well worth the effort. I think it's got a good chance to make all of our jobs easier and for us to have a say in what the future is going to be like.
Can you tell me a ballpark figure of how many Cape Elizabeth citizens are currently involved?
I have no idea. There are about 40 people on the board of directors, and there were 400 or 500 at the October big meeting, and the December one, there were several hundred. And I have no idea how many were from Cape Elizabeth, but I assume some because you have a very active community.
Are there any other comments or questions, either for Nick, anyone, or anyone else?
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, Councilor Mastin.
I'll move that the town of Cape Elizabeth make a contribution of 12.5 cents per every living soul in Cape Elizabeth, or $1,025 for the purpose of supporting Vision 2000, and that this amount be taken out of
Town
Council contingency.
Second motion.
Very good. So it's 12.5 cents for every living soul, not to exceed 1,025. Based on, there may have been a few births this evening. Okay. 1,025. It's been made and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those, oh, yes, Councilor Coleman, go ahead.
Yes, I would like to just make a last statement here because I'm going to vote against this. And I just wanted to be clear about one thing. I'm a practicing psychiatrist, and the challenges here, the task force, I think are wonderful ideas, in particular challenge 5, nurturing the human spirit. I hope that I do this all day long with the patients that I treat. But to me, the goals and the questions that are asked in this document are so ambiguous. What must be done to assure that every individual is treated with respect, without interference or prejudice from others? How can we build a personal and collective sense of safety and security without which there is little hope for the future? I think that Cape Elizabeth citizens couldn't be more actively involved in the work in the town. And I see this as a very good idea, but to continue to deplete the contingency fund with every request that comes across the council desk here, I think at some point we have to take a stand.
Thank you. Councilor Jordan.
I'm still not convinced that it isn't a project that COG could do, but maybe if COG had it, they would increase our fee to be a member. I don't know, but you're getting a lot of people together and you get a lot of ideas, and I'm pretty much in agreement with Councilor Creamer that I think a lot of them questions are a little way out, and maybe you can narrow them down, and I wish you luck, but I'm going to vote against it.
Yes, Councilor Coggeshall.
Are you going to be coming back to us for a matching donation next year? This is supposedly a two-year project.
Correct, two-year project. Next year I'll come back. If we don't produce good results in the year, I encourage you not to give it to us.
Get the money back?
The check's in the mail.
No money back guarantees there. In that case, I'd like to have a vote on this issue. All those in favor of the motion that we have before us, please raise your hands. All those opposed? It passes 4-3.
Thank you very much for your consideration.
Thanks for coming, Nick. So moving back to item number 24, which is a request from the Planning Board to adopt the Planning Board bylaws and take any necessary action. We have in front of us this evening some information that the Planning Board has forwarded to us regarding revised rules and regulations for that board. We have some other comments that have been made by others regarding those suggestions, and I would like to now open it up to the Council for their discussion.
Mr. Chairman, do you want us to go through these tonight and kind of throw them out, or do you want to have a workshop type thing? Ideas here.
Whatever is the will of the council, I believe we could probably reach a consensus tonight on these. But if we feel it's going to be too drawn out, given that we do have an 11 o'clock deadline facing us, I don't want to rush any discussions, but I'm prepared to discuss six problems or six areas that could be changed, of which I understand certain planning board members are amenable to change. These aren't cast in cement here, so I think it may move along quicker than we anticipate. Why don't we try discussing it? Translated, why don't we try it now? I'd like to start off by asking about 1B1 in terms of whether the chairman and vice chairman could be elected at the first March meeting rather than at the January meeting so that the new people could come, could be involved in the voting. I feel that's only fair, appropriate, and I feel that it should certainly be. So I would wish to amend that to read that the chair and vice chair would be elected at the first regular March meeting, by which we would have the new members in place. Yes.
May I ask the manager a question? Isn't that the way the majority of the committees are marches a thing?
Yes.
So I'll go along with you. I think that should be amended.
Yes, Councilor.
I'm just wondering what the process is here. Are we amending this, or are we going to make recommendations and send this back to the
committee? It was my understanding that we are amending it and then would adopt it, and the planning board would then. It'll be sent to the. Okay.
I wouldn't agree with that part.
Okay.
I would like to make recommendations and ask the planning board to consider our recommendations.
Okay.
And then to come back to us.
We have somebody listening.
But all I meant was ultimately we will adopt it. It doesn't have to be tonight. But it's not something we're suggesting to them for rules. Ultimately, we will adopt it, and this will be their rules. If we would like to. I agree with your process. We should make suggestions tonight.
Make the six suggestions that you have, and we can see if there's a consensus on each item, and then anybody can make any additions after that. I think that'll.
Very good. I'd like to suggest then on 1B4 that the whole paragraph be eliminated based on the fact that the board itself doesn't have to decide or shouldn't decide what it needs for planning and town assistance, et cetera. I think that should be made by someone else, so I don't necessarily agree that the board itself shall decide where support services shall be rendered.
Question.
Yes.
Who should make that decision?
Who makes it in other boards?
Who the support is for the planning board?
The town manager makes those decisions in conformance with policies and budgets approved by the town council.
And the support staff would be by request, I would say.
Now, the planning board, we're going to, continue to supply support staff. The real question here is they said the staff would be so-and-so. You know, positions evolve, they change. I just don't feel comfortable having that in the bylaws. You know, for example, when the planner comes on, maybe we won't find that we need the code enforcement administrator back here changing tapes every meeting. There might be more effective utilization of staff.
I agree with what he's saying.
Yeah.
I don't know.
So that would be stricken then?
Well, that's the recommendation.
That would be the recommendation. We're not making the final decision here. Don't get anyone worried about it. Another suggestion that I have. I seem to be on a roll. Oh, more discussion about that?
Are we worried about like there's something we shouldn't?
Or? No, not at all.
Okay.
2A regards the time of the planning board meetings. I don't know, my own feeling is that if it came into conformance with our time and those of other boards, which I believe all boards start at 7:30, I think that's appropriate. And not having the last agenda item, though maybe their agenda items last much longer than ours, so the 10 o'clock instead of the 11 o'clock.
May I speak?
Yes.
That's why you've stayed, I think.
but I'm Marion Guthrie, and we really have no problems with any changes that you're making, but I did want to explain to you the 10 o'clock cutoff. I don't want the council to have the impression that our meetings are ending at 10. That particular rule means that the last agenda item comes up at 10. That means we could go, depending on that agenda item and the complicated nature of it, until 11 or 11:30. Last winter, I can remember meetings going on until 12:30, a quarter of one, and we were home at 1. And I would urge you to keep this particular item in our rules. Last month, we started at 5 o'clock in the afternoon, with a short break for for dinner and then resumed and took up our last agenda item at 10, and I think we were home at 10:30 or a quarter of 11, whatever, which was really wonderful. So I hope that you will take us into consideration because we do begin at 7 o'clock. And unfortunately, everything that we decide is essentially of a global nature. And I don't think that we can make intelligent decisions at midnight and 1 o'clock. Unfortunately, the decisions that we make often are forever. So just keep that in mind. Okay? Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Frank, I have no problem with one board starting at 7 p.m. Having been before planning boards in other towns, I understand their very full agendas, the need to move through them as quickly as possible while doing so very thoroughly. I also agree with the having the last agenda item by 10 o'clock. I, too, have sat through some lengthy planning board evenings and will not comment on the kinds of decisions one makes after 10 o'clock, but I think 10 o'clock is the appropriate time to have the last item on the agenda.
So you're in favor of 7 and 10?
I'm in favor of 7 and 10.
Okay. Councilor Amaro?
I think the 7 to 10 is fine also, but I'd like to add that when there are people who make requests to be on the agenda and they cannot be accommodated in that 7 to 10 agenda format, that they then a special meeting would have to be set up to accommodate requests. Otherwise, I think we're going to get such a backlog, and it's going to slow down the process. So that, to me, that would be another reason for having a special meeting, would it be?
Okay.
Yes.
Could I ask Marion a question?
Yes.
Marion, do you think that have you been operating under the 7 and 10 parentheses?
I think that the 10 o'clock cutoff day began maybe two times ago. But we weren't aware that everything had to be ratified by the town council when we meeting.
Well, do you feel that having that pressure point at the end of the evening speeds things along or moves things along?
Yes.
And not speed, please.
Yes,
but
I think it does move things along. And I wish there were a process which, you know, would move planning along faster. I don't know the answer to that. But I do feel that we stayed on guard, you know, with this new rule.
Well, as you know, we have a rule that we can't take up a new item on the agenda or off the agenda after 11 o'clock.
Yes.
And I think that for us, it's worked. I think it puts
mm-hmm.
pressure
mm-hmm.
on.
We can do it with a vote of the council.
So I'm perfectly happy. If that works for you, the 7 and 10, I'm happy with it.
Okay. Yes.
Very briefly, I concur with Jane and Nancy that if they found this to be a much more effective way, an efficient way to operate, then they should be the ones. They should be able to start at 7. In fact, I would possibly recommend that other town boards start their meeting at 7 o'clock, give you that extra half hour.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That was an interesting suggestion. but we agree in terms of conformity anyway. You're just saying conform to 7, which is good. Did you have your hand up?
Yes, I did. I just think with consistency at hand here, I have the last three sets of minutes of the planning board. One meeting started at 7:30, another started at 7, a third started at 7, and then a note indicated that a special meeting on June 16th, on a Thursday, was to start at 5:30. So I do think there needs to be some consistency. I would hate to have a citizen expecting a standardized starting time and find out that that was a half hour ago on a given night. So I think we just need to make a clear starting time.
And I also think that we should pursue this because it would be very difficult once it's ingrained in the citizens' minds that every board started at a certain time, but one doesn't. There could be some problems with that. It's just a fact of life. So I'd like to see them all start at the same time, so when citizens think municipal affairs start at 7:30 or 7 or whatever. I think there's a plus to that. But I will be in favor of the 7 to 10 also at this time.
Mr. Chairman, I kind of an agreement that if the planning board wants to start at 5, they want to start at 4. They can start any time they want, or as far as their workshop and what have you, before the meeting. But I think if they're going to have public meetings and people pretty much get geared to a 7:30 deal, I feel the 7:30 should be pretty much standardized, which is standardized within the community. And a lot of people get geared to that. Now, the 10 o'clock deal, I would be pretty disappointed, but I guess it don't bother the people, that if I was on the agenda for 9:45 and the agenda went along and somebody else took my time, I'd be pretty disappointed if I had to wait until after 10 o'clock and then go home and not be heard after I was set up and had my people here. And I don't think that rule should be there. I think the planning board should be able to control that themselves, have the agenda laid out, and if somebody took longer than their appointed time beforehand, then they would have to move it on or tell that person way in advance, you better go home, we're not going to get to you tonight.
Are there any other comments about that suggestion? Otherwise, we have a consensus and we will move on to another concern, which is Section 5, A and B, that rules can be dispensed with or suspended by only a majority vote, and B, a clarification added that any rule that is amended or changed shall be approved by the town council. Those are, A, I have a concern on, B, I would suggest that we add the wording that I just mentioned, shall be approved by the town council. Do all boards, Mr. Manager, have the right to suspend or dispense with rules? I mean, does the zoning board, does...
Those that have bylaws, of which I'd say about half do, generally have, you know, that their rules of procedure shall be Robert's Rules of Order, without getting into the details of it.
Thus, they can suspend.
They can suspend based on Robert's rules, yes.
But our own rules require that 5 it would take in order to suspend the rules, rather than a majority.
Council has its own set of rules, yes.
Does anyone else share my concern with just a simple majority being able to suspend the rules?
Yes. I find that they're following Robert's rules, except for that, and I don't see any reason not to totally adhere to Robert's rules. All board,
even though we don't.
which would then require how many to suspend the rules? 4. Okay, so we are in agreement there? Because then we can, okay. 6A3 regards, prior to the meeting, the planning board secretary will make copies of the agenda available to the applicants, and also has, I don't know whether it was discussed, also available to the abutters, rather than just the applicants. Are we presently mailing the agenda to the abutters as well? Could that be? Mm-hmm. I would like to see abutters also notified.
Several people have requested that early on in the process that abutters receive some notification, so I think that this would be interesting.
Of course, the abutters can always request to get the mailing, the same mailing that the planning board gets. Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
I have some problems with the word adequate in 6A2. All planning board agenda items submitted by applicants must be determined by the code enforcement administrator or town planner to be adequate to be placed on the agenda at least 10 days prior to a regular planning board meeting. Unless the submission is adequate, it cannot be presented at the board meeting, and it's also used in B1, adequate, prior to its becoming an agenda item. I find that very fuzzy, and I think what is meant is a complete application. Even if it's a preliminary application, which I take it is not quite as detailed as a final, it should be complete. All the information that's asked for on the form, it is a form, isn't it, Marion?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It should be complete, not just adequate.
The problem with that is it was a court decision several years ago that only the board can determine whether or not an application is complete. Staff is not permitted to do that. And this is a kind of the adequate language is kind of for the staff to be able to say, come on, you just don't have any material here. You really don't belong on the agenda. And then it kind of leaves...
adequate is just such a flat...
It is.
Meaningless
it
word.
Is.
Why don't we say acceptable? Hmm.
Most towns give the staff wide latitude on keeping items off the agenda when they're not ready. You know, I think the planning board experience here would show that, you know, it's an embarrassment to everyone sometimes when these items go on. You know, they're rarely not in any position to be discussed.
That just worries me. Just meaningless words.
Councilor Krillman.
I would just like to get back to the issue of Section 6A3 regarding the copies of the agenda. Should copies of the agenda be sent to immediate abutters of the subdivision or site plan? We hammered out on August 3rd, 1988, our town council goals, which included in 3B, providing early notification of planning board agendas to citizens to enhance our communication. Certainly the complaint has come to me from several citizens that they are notified far too late in the process, especially with regard to the planning board agendas. And I would like to see abutters notified as soon as possible under these types of circumstances. And I think it's a good opportunity to begin to fulfill some of our goals.
Thank you very much for that comment. Yes.
Mr. Chairman, I don't know how that could be done because it is the developer who provides the town with the names of the abutters during the preliminary plan process. Isn't that true?
Yes.
So does that mean that the planning, who is going to be responsible for getting the names of all of these abutters right up?
It'd be a town staff responsibility. The plan would be the first time an item actually appears on an agenda, a notice would be sent. You know, unfortunately, we get a lot, people want to have notices before it's even on the agenda. But this would be once the board chairman sits down and an agenda is printed with the time, not the preliminary agenda, but the actual agenda, that would be sent out to any abutter of a proposal that is appearing there the first time. Or one that was there 6 months ago and is reappearing. Something like that.
The only other clarification that I'd like to make would be under C on the very last page, which is mentioning the fact, rather than stating that the chairman of the Conservation Commission, just stating the Conservation Commission itself, and also there has been some question as to whether the Public Works Director and the town manager should be included in this list. I don't have a big problem with it because it does say other town officials, and I do believe that the planning board would be certainly amenable, or when necessary would talk to either of those gentlemen or women, so I believe that's appropriate. But I would like to see, just for the sake of cleaning it up a little bit, having it say just Conservation Commission. Yes, Councilor.
I have another section I want to bring up. Okay. Section 3-4.
Well, can we finish with this one?
Oh, excuse me.
I think that Public Works Director and Manager need to be specifically included. Having presented plans to town officials and other towns and cities that they're routinely involved, especially since we don't right now have a planner. I think that's important.
Okay. How do others feel? Do we want to specifically have them, the Public Works Director and the town manager, mentioned in this?
They're going to want to get out the list them. Otherwise, just put down this town official.
Okay, so we will then list them because they've broken others out, so why shouldn't we? Yeah.
Now, where are we at? We got out in the field there.
We just finished with C. So yes. Now we're moving on to another.
No, I haven't finished.
Oh, very good. Okay. We're moving nowhere until you're finished.
Okay, thank you.
Public Works
Town. Public Works.
You're going to have Public Works and the manager mentioned there, or you're going to strike it out and say
There was a consensus to have it.
You're going to strike chairman of the Conservation Commission? You're
yes.
going to strike chairman?
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
I'm on first base with you.
Okay. And it wasn't an intentional walk either. I like it. It was a clean base hit. This baseball analogy is going to really drive someone crazy.
Yeah.
Yes, Counselor.
On Section 3-4, it says that the chairman would decide whether or not an individual board member would have a conflict. In most other boards, the actual board itself votes as to whether or not they think the person should have a conflict. That's more consistent, and I don't think the chairman should do it by him or herself, that it should be a vote of the board.
I agree with that.
I'm in full agreement there.
I checked state statutes on conflict of interest, and there wasn't language on that. It's interesting. Expect the fines to be a forerunner.
Mr. Chairman, you can see that these rules were taken up at 12:30.
Another good reason to vote for the 10 o'clock rule, in my opinion. Is there any other discussion?
I thought they was in-house rules.
Phyllis, where was that, the conflict of interest?
Section 3-4.
Page
3.
3A,
Chairman.
I hope that we send the suggested changes back to the planning board for their consideration.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded to send them back for their consideration with friendly suggestions offered. All those in favor? Any opposed? So it's unanimously passed to send these back to the planning board. And we move on to our next agenda item, which is to consider formally authorizing a bond anticipation note and taking a necessary action. As the councilors and the members of the public will remember, we've already authorized the bond anticipation note at our last meeting. What we're doing here is just formalizing the legal language that is required, which is in front of us this evening. Does the town manager have anything you'd like to add? Or?
No.
I would then move acceptance of the bond anticipation note.
I'll second.
All those in favor? Any opposed? No. So the language, the formal legal language has been adopted. Now to item 27, which is to consider establishing a town planner position and take any necessary action. Mike McGovern, town manager. I've now given every title, so go ahead.
I've come up with a few feel.
I'm going to call a recess. What does that mean? Go ahead.
This is in your budget this year, you adopted the position of town planner, effective around the 1st of January. For purposes of discussion, you really have three issues here before you. One is the timetable. Number two is the selection process, and within that a subheading on how this position will fall into the organizational structure. And number three is the job description. The schedule provides that the advertising essentially take place during October, selection during November, and the appointment, the actual person coming in the end of December, the beginning of January. I'm proposing that it be a staff position reporting to the town manager without the titular status of department head. There's a proposed selection committee consisting of 5 members, and there's a 3-page job description, which I won't read due to the lateness of the hour. Didn't plan to read anyway.
Very good.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Yes, and the manager, just again for clarification, is asking for the formal adoption of this position this evening, which is, as you all remember, in our fiscal 1989 budget. I would now entertain any questions regarding the job description or what's upcoming. Councilor Amaro?
Yes, just one question on the selection committee. One of the 5 people is an appointee of the town manager. I wondered why the town manager. I know that the town manager makes the final decision, but it makes sense to me for the town manager to also serve on that committee.
I've heard that question asked quite a lot today, as a matter of fact, yes.
The manager plans to participate in the process. In other communities, as I've known, the manager has sat in, has kind of taken a back seat, be more an observer, let the group run with it. Kind of, you get the sense that you get more of a flavor of what's going on. You're not on, on nervous, getting questions, not nervous is the right word, but you can take more of an overall view of the process. I do plan to sit in the interviews. This group will make a recommendation to me. I think all of you, if I'm still the manager in December, which I expect to be, I'm not shy, and I'll let my feelings known, but I didn't want to get an odd-numbered committee. I didn't want to get an unwieldy committee. And yet, I did want to have some flexibility in asking an additional person to serve that would tend to try to balance off the other members chosen. And that's what I'm looking to do with that position. But if you want me to serve on it, that's fine.
My only problem is, it seems to, when I really analyze it, it seems to take you out of the process almost completely, in that you will have a committee that will have scrutinized and then make come to great pains to make a recommendation. I don't see how you could possibly reject the recommendation, which in effect would completely take you out of the process, which I think is unhealthy, given your level of expertise and trust you have with us.
I plan to be there, but one step removed. If you want me to, I'm very open on it. I had difficulty with the same issue myself, I will be an active participant if that's what you like.
Yes, Councilor.
After all, Michael, you're going to have to work with this guy. I mean, he's going to have to work for you. He or she.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
And it would seem to me that you ought to be on the same wavelength and be simpatico, you know?
Amen.
And in light of that, is there any feeling whatsoever of why doesn't the town manager just interview and make the selection? I don't see why we're ruling that out completely, given that we are setting it up that it's not a department head, it's basically a staff person under the town manager. And I'm not sure it's completely appropriate or needed to, although I understand, you know, the input from these different sources, but I would still entertain the notion of just having Michael interview and make a selection. Because
if he's
one of five or one of six, how can he could easily be overruled.
I really don't mind the idea of a screening committee. I think that that's always very helpful. Do you have any idea, Michael, what kind of response you're going to get?
From what I've heard, we'll get a fairly good.
It also helps to have other people reading through the resumes and back cuts down.
One reason why, you know, I kind of came up with this is to make it very clear that I was not one of five members of the selection committee, that I do in fact have the final decision.
Right.
And I want to make sure that is not lost.
Compromise? I can see you're really dragging your feet on being on this selection committee. Have you a member ex officio?
That's really what I was intending anyway.
I'm comfortable with that. I've been on a selection committee before for the town where Mike was Mike or John Henshey probably, was an ex officio member and had the final say, and it worked out very well for everybody concerned, I think.
He was ex officio but had the final say? What do you mean?
Ex officio.
Oh, you mean, okay. And then he could either accept or reject
the committee.
Okay.
But he sat in on all the interviews.
So it would be then a six member committee with Michael as an ex officio. Is that basically an amendment?
That's really what I wanted and what this recommendation was. I just
okay, so we would be
well.
Yeah,
would someone move
that.
Move acceptance with an
of the job description and
why don't we get it out on the floor? We'll continue the discussion. We'll just get it out. Okay,
and,
so it's
and the procedure for selecting the job description, the procedure, and amending the committee, the selection committee, to include the manager ex officio without a vote.
So it has been moved and seconded to accept the town planner position as outlined in front of us with the amendment as Councilor Masterton just stated. Now we will move to Councilor Creelman for discussion.
My assumption is that advertising in the Maine Sunday Telegram will reap local talent, and the advertising in professional planning journals, that will be a regional process that would pretty much go to 50 states.
National.
Yes. National process. Okay. I think that's important. If my memory is right, it's approximately a $30,000 salary.
A little less than that.
A little less. Is that going to be stipulated in the advertisement? It isn't in this document.
The salary range will be listed.
The range. Okay.
Counselor?
Nowhere in this proposal did I see anything. Is there a specific certification for town planners? Do they have to take boards and have some sort of certificate or just a degree?
No.
Also, I would like to see more clarification of the relationship with the tax assessor and the CEO, so there's a clearer breakdown of exactly who has what responsibilities within the office and who would step in if the planner wasn't there, and not have the public being told, well, the planner's not here, he does this, so we can't help you right now.
It's a point well taken. I'll make sure when we establish the position, the in-house protocols, that is
thank you.
Any other comments? Councilor Jordan.
I think I can see the manager's point, because that is done quite a lot in other areas now, especially in the police department, different areas. Like the chief in Cape Elizabeth might go to another community along to two or three other and interview applicants and then make a recommendation to that community. And Cape Elizabeth also does that. They have other people interview these applicants and the recommendation comes to the chief. And I think this is pretty much is what Mike is thinking of. Let the other people go out. You stay in line with it. And I think it works out very well. And also the fire service does the same thing. They have different groups from other communities come in and interview applicants. And this is pretty much what you've got in mind, Mike?
Yeah, I just didn't enunciate too. I wrote this in 100-degree heat in the air-conditioned town hall last week and just didn't
wait, enunciate. The citizens are getting concerned. Everything's getting ready at 12 in the morning. And
no, that's just laying the groundwork for next year's budget.
Yes, I'm fully aware. We may have to suspend the rules. All those in favor of adopting the town planner's position as outlined, any opposed? It passes unanimously 7-0, the guidelines and job description for the new town planner. Moving on to our next agenda item, which is to consider the appointment of the Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee and take any necessary action. I would ask the Appointments Committee Chair, Councilor Amaro, to explain a little bit about this trust fund and also to talk about her appointments, the appointment recommendations.
This committee was established by the council a couple of months ago, and the purpose of it is to look into the will of Thomas Jordan, which was established in 1825, left a large tract of land across from the dump, including some area, the transfer station, including some area that the transfer station is built on, to see exactly what is meant by that will, to have some research done, and to bring forward from our legal counsel the opinion as to what that property can be used for to best service the poor people. Also, there is some money in trust from land that has been leased on the poor farm. And there is land. There will be money once we sign the easement with Rachel Carson, which will be added to that fund. And we're also asking this committee to make suggestions and to set up guidelines on how that money can be used to help the poor in the community. And there are several other charges also, which I won't go into because of the lateness of the night. But I am really pleased tonight to bring before you a committee of seven outstanding Cape citizens, all of whom are bringing a different aspect and a different personality and a different expertise to this committee. And I think it's going to be an exciting committee for all of them to serve on. And I have great expectations, as I think our other appointments committee members do for this committee. So at this time, I'd like to place before you these names for the Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee. David Wakeland, chairman of the committee. Phyllis Cogsall, Reverend Walter Brown, Penelope Carson, Paula House, John Lescure, and Sue Terry. And this committee is under a deadline to report back to us by December 1st, 1988. So I place those names in nomination.
Second the motion. With one comment. Yes. Did former Councilor Carson want to have you make that, write that introductory statement?
No, she did not.
Okay, all those in favor of the having these people on this committee, as has just been outlined, please raise your hands. Are there any opposed? Seeing none opposed, it passes unanimously as to the makeup of the new Thomas Jordan Trust Study Committee. And thank you all very much for coming forward in terms of wanting to serve on this committee. I would now like to make a motion that we, as a town council, suspend the rules. And what rule I'm specifically referring to is a town council rule stating that no agenda item shall be taken up past 11 o'clock. The reason I'm making the motion is that we do have a few other items. Granted, nothing is a given in this business, but these seem to be ones that are more of a routine nature. I don't think there's any hotbed of controversy in terms of people that are going to be coming forward, so I feel appropriate in this situation to make the motion to suspend the rule so that we may take up the remaining two items that we have and can complete our business this evening.
I'll second.
All those in favor of suspending the rules in terms of the time limitation?
Any opposed? It passes unanimously 7-0. We can now relax. And I can stop acting like a steamroller. But at least we don't have to, they'll say, that guy steamrolls everything. What is with him? Item 29, to consider a lease agreement with the Cape Elizabeth School Department for temporary classrooms and take any necessary action. What we are doing here, as those of you who have read the packet know, is formalizing the lease for the portable classrooms between the owners, which is the town of Cape Elizabeth, and the lessee, which is the Cape Elizabeth School Board. We have 3,248 square feet, $7.50 a square foot, $26,340 a year shall be paid for the leasing thereof from the school committee to the town. Any comments?
Just two very brief ones. The lease amount, $26,340 per year, or $7.50 per square foot, is based on the fact that that's the maximum amount that the State Department of Education will reimburse. That's how that amount was arrived at. The second point I'd like to make is that this cannot exceed a period of greater than 5 years. This is a one-year agreement renewable, but the Planning Board has set a five-year limit on it, and in order to change that, we'd have to go back to the Planning Board. And I only said two comments, but since we have 2 minutes, I would like to mention that that they're just about done at this point. The contractor has done an exceptional job on them. If any of you were around, would like to see them, I would encourage you to drop by, and either myself or a representative of the school department could take you over. They really do a nice job tying together the schools and providing needed space.
Thank you, Mr.
What do they do with around the outside of it?
The bottom? I discussed that with them, and they're looking at possibly doing something for the winter to cut down on the wind blowing through.
Councilor Massey?
I was a little disappointed to read that no landscaping would be done.
Is that in here?
No,
In the planning board meeting, minutes, it said that they were supposed to do some landscaping around the...
We're going to. There is not anything here prohibiting it. I mean, when you set aside the funds for it, there was a set aside of some additional funds above the contract price, and that money is for landscaping.
So is the town going to do the landscaping?
Cooperatively with the school department.
Any further comments? If not, I'd make a motion to accept the lease as it is before us.
I'll second.
Moved and seconded. All those in favor? Any opposed? No. So unanimously, we accept the lease with the school board. Final item on the agenda this evening, to consider the appointment of an acting town manager to serve when the town manager is on vacation and take any necessary action. We have had, as a council, over the last 2 years, I'd say, evolve a consensus that one person, for the sake of continuity, which we believe is important and certain experiences gained, will continue to be the acting town manager rather than on a rotating basis in Michael's absence, either on vacation or away on extended town business. As such, I would suggest that Deborah Pizzo, who is our town clerk, serve as acting town manager. I would make a motion therein from September 17th to October 2nd and October 22nd through the 27th, where our town manager will be leaving.
Out of town, not leaving.
Can I give you a vote of town?
Always those few little dangling words that leaving our town.
You've given him the message already.
Well, he already gave the hint about December. I don't know what that was all about.
No.
Very
congratulations,
good.
Debbie.
All those in favor? Any opposed? Congratulations, Debbie. I think. Or here's some Excedrin, Debbie. Citizens discussion of items not on the agenda.
Mr. Chairman.
Oh.
I see none coming forward. Councilor Masterton.
Now it's time for the council. Regarding this August 3rd note from the Greater Portland Council of Governments regarding the PAC process.
Yes.
Are we going to have any input into that?
I wrote a proposed response Friday and today. It's just about finished typing. I'm going to be doing is sending you out a packet the end of the week with that and a few other things that come in the last few days, asking that you respond to me if there's anything in there that you object to or something additional you'd like to see in there. And then it will be on your September agenda for formal action. I just didn't want to not circulate it before September and have a counselor bring something out up at that meeting without the other counselors having had a chance to react to it. So, yes.
And you really did a terrific job, Mike, on your goal. Very well pulled together.
Yes, Counselor.
Would the town manager just briefly tell the town council how the meeting last Thursday evening went on the Sawyer Road project?
Yes, we had a meeting on the Sawyer Road project. Councilor Greenlaw was in attendance. Myself, very few citizens, I would say.
Eight.
You counted? And there were more engineers and contracting officials there than citizens. Of those that were there, I'd say it went very well. There was concerns about a few trees, and those were addressed.
I thought it was an excellent example of town communicating with the citizens and having the consultants involved. That went very well, the citizens I talked to.
The projects, I know you didn't ask this, but projects coming along, if any of you have been up on Pickett Street, it looks like
Hell.
Nagasaki just went through there. The third falling of the cable. You know, I think it's, right now it looks terrible. You know, I think the whole project is certainly the most discouraging aspect of it, to see all those old trees come down. It'll never be the same, and you know, I think that portion is very sad. I am hopeful that once the road gets in, you know, it gets back smooth looking, it'll look somewhat better, but it will never be as beautiful as it was 2 weeks ago.
To move off that somber note, is there any other? Could we close on an could we close on an upbeat note? Yes, Councilor Jordan.
I just want to make a comment on a memo here about the Cape Elizabeth Affordable Housing Committee, and you're going to have a meeting August 24th downstairs here. You're calling in the developers. Or you're asking them to come in. And
the committee has asked that.
The committee has asked them. Now, are they going to notify them other than the papers? Are they going to send them an invitation? Or what are they going to do? I mean,
they got a list from the building inspector's office of developers working.
Okay, well, I think this is great. I think they get them in, and I hope that they're going to feel free to open up and tell you what they want you to hear. And is that the idea of it?
Yep. Yes, ma'am.
Are there any other comments?
Yep, it's all right with me.
If not, I would entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor of adjourning? Very good. Passes unanimously. Thank you all here and at home for watching.
I also have an announcement of the first annual Cape Elizabeth Town Employees Golf Tournament, September 7th at the Buddha Club. Something was strove for a long time. If anyone would like to participate, I can be available for you.
Jane will, won't you, Jane?
Can you do that? Anyone else?
Let me take one.
Frank.
We have up to six foursomes that's going to be extended to the council, to all full-time employees and to the fire department volunteers.
Good for you.
Good idea.
After food?
There's prizes. There's $100 in prizes.
Oh, booby prizes?
But goodness only knows. I'm afraid to ask what they were.